Hi, everybody. Welcome to the UW Robotics Colloquium. This quarter, we have, a great lineup of speakers coming up, and I'm really excited to kick it off with Tomas Lozano-Perez. He's one of the pioneers in robotics. Tomas is currently faculty at MIT. Well, I think, is it true he got all his degrees, and since then, you spent all your career at MIT?
Yes.
That's true. Okay. So he's been there for a while. Tomas has done some very influential work also in computer vision and machine learning. He's a fellow of the IEEE, of the AAAI. He's also a certified pioneer because he won the IEEE Robotics Pioneer Award.
See the arrows?
And robotics especially, he has introduced the notion of configuration space planning, which is something that's really crucial for manipulation planning these days. And over the last years, he, and I think especially also in collaboration with Leslie Kaelbling, has done a lot of work in not only looking at motion planning per se, but also seeing it in the context of, for example, higher level task planning and how to deal with uncertainty. And I think that's some of the work he's going to tell us today about.
Thank you, Dieter. It's nice to be here. It's my first time at UW, so it's an experience. Thank you for taking the time to come to show me around and to come listen. All right, so what I'll be doing is telling you about this work that Dieter referred to about integrating task and motion planning in belief space. This is work with Leslie Kaelbling. And I'll tell you about the kinds of things we've been doing. It's work which progresses slowly because it's two professors writing code. So all the students in the room can identify with, oh my God, right? So that's exactly what's been going on here. So I apologize ahead of time for that. All right, so what? I should start by saying that, please come in. I should start by saying that what I'm most interested in is convincing you that there's an interesting class of problems that need to be addressed, rather than that the particular solutions that we have come up with are the right ones. But so mostly the message is the kind of problems that we're addressing. So the kind of problem that is what we call an aspirational goal, something that we would like to be able to do, is to be able to come into a kitchen like this and do something, right? So put yourself into the mind of the robot here. What's the robot's reaction? Right. That's our motivating problem. So in a nutshell, this is exactly what we're trying to do. We're trying to figure out how to choose actions in the presence of a tremendous amount of uncertainty, very complex domains. We don't really understand how to do planning in something that's that complicated. Let me try to sort of kind of set the stage by saying some of the things that we do know how to do, and then ultimately then the kind of problem that we're trying to work on now. So Dieter mentioned robot configuration space, and the idea that we can do motion planning in the configuration space of the robot is something that most of you have heard about. So we can plan tasks autonomously for robots. This is a robot that's doing re-grasping. The only thing that's interesting about this is that this was 1985. So it's a project that a number of us did back then called Handy. But it is doing motion planning. It's a little more slowly. The computers were a little slower then. Finding the motions of a robot to move from one location to another, once you know what the locations are and so on, is something that we kind of know how to do now, which is great. The thing that makes it hard is what happens when there's uncertainty. So one of the key challenges is, if you've done any motion planning and stuff, you plan all your motions, everything looks really cool, you try to run it in the world, and wham, it runs into something, it drops it or whatever. The first motion planning thing that I did, which was at IBM in 1977, we had these styrofoam blocks which we used as the obstacles. And, after a couple of weeks, they were styrofoam balls instead of blocks because, we kept clipping them. So uncertainty is a big thing. And the idea is that basically we shouldn't be planning in the space of the joints of the robot, we really need to consider uncertainty in a fundamental way. And one way to do that is to at least structure the computations is to use the idea of belief space, that is the probability distributions over the states of the world. And we have done some work in that area. This is a work from Kai-Jun Shao, one of our PhD students, and this was like, 5 or 6 years ago. And the robot here knows the shape of the object pretty well, but it didn't know where it started off, and it's planning a sequence of actions that will ultimately terminate in a grasp that is productive. Not just that it's in the hand, but in this case, that it can actually actuate the trigger. And what it's doing is it's planning in the belief space, understanding the effect of the actions, not just from that the mean is going to change, but also that that you'll get perceptions from the contacts that you can use to localize the object and so on. So the idea of belief space kind of allows you to structure the integrated view of action and perception and plan in that space. So that's we think it's a kind of fundamental sort of observation that we should be planning in the belief space. Now, the trouble is that the kinds of things that I showed you there were very simple tasks. They're very short range. You want to grasp one object. In the earlier one, there was a few more steps, but it's still relatively short range. And what we would like to do is move towards a situation in which we're planning tasks like, making dinner, okay? So the question is, how do we approach the problem of making dinner? So we're not going to do it with classic motion planning, okay? We're not going to generate points in the space of, the state of my kitchen and try to connect them with straight lines and then see whether there's collision, right? That's not going to work. No matter how clever your sampling algorithms and so on, it's just not appropriate. So the question is, how could you develop a technique for doing search in that kind of domain? And our approach has been to look back in time and think about the fact that there was a whole field in AI of planning. It's called, high-level planning. And they've developed some really clever ways of structuring searches in very big spaces, exploiting the fact that the spaces are factored. You can break up. So, for example, what you know about one object and what you know about another object can be treated somewhat independently. And you can use that structure and the structure of what you know about the actions, preconditions, and so on to arrange for searches that are much bigger than that you can do by just the classic motion planning technique. So this is work primarily of Kaelin Garrett, one of our students, and he's developed a planner that uses insights from the symbolic motion planning literature to structure search in for very long sequences of actions. In this case, without uncertainty, but there's some interesting ideas that come out in this kind of work that I'll touch upon later in the rest of the talk. I'm not going to spend too much time on that. So now, what we did here is kind of, in some sense, went from the motion planning stuff, and we said, okay, in order to do more tasks that are more complicated, we need to think about the structuring of the task, not as just an unidentified point in some high-dimensional space, and you're kind of moving around blindly, but using the structure of what you know about the actions and the task in order to structure a more effective search, and in particular, to build good heuristics for doing search in those spaces. So now the question then comes up, okay, so how do we go to this spot up here in which what we're trying to do is lifted, factored, geometric POMDPs, that is a situation in which we have fundamental uncertainty over geometric domains and we're trying to do complex tasks that involve long horizons. So that is the corner where I want to talk to you about. And we'll build on some of these ideas from the other three corners, but that's the key area. So this is to establish credibility that I'm not just doing hot air. This is a robot actually running such a planner. It was told to pick up the blue object and put it in this corner. It looked, it saw that there was something in the way, decided to move it out of the way, put it there. It's been told to put this object in this corner, and this is all sped up, by the way. Whenever I'm asked about real time, I say I'm only interested in finite time, not real time. In fact, in this one, it's interesting because it had a bug, my bug, in the forward model of pushing, so it was only going halfway. But it knew enough to look and says it's not in the right place and push it again. Okay, so it illustrated that a certain robustness that was part of the goal. In this one, the robot has been asked to leave the room. It wakes up and it sees the chairs that are in the way, and it then plans to put them someplace that won't be in the way. When this was running, it grabbed this chair and then said, I started doing this and then kind of going out of the room, and we said, oh, it's a bug, let's turn it off. But no, it knew what it was doing. It actually went to the right place. So, this is very far from making dinner, but it does illustrate fairly robust behavior in the real world in tasks that involve geometry, complicated motions, and uncertainty, and that's what I'd like to kind of talk about. So this is the real title of the talk, but if I had done this, you would have, nobody would be here, which maybe is a good thing. You can leave now. So what we have is this kind of intractable problem, long horizon lifted factor geometric POMDPs. The only thing that I know how to solve, and Leslie knows more things, but she's pretending that, that that's the only thing we know how to solve, is heuristic search. I don't know anything else, so we're going to reduce this to this. And in order to do that, we have to make a lot of steps. And I'm going to try to give you an idea of what some of those steps are. Okay, so POMDP is a partially observable Markov decision processes. Are basically a beautiful mathematical formulation for the problem of planning under uncertainty. The basic idea is that you have a set of observations coming in and your actions, and you have some, say, recursive estimator that builds a probability distributions over the state, which you call the belief. And then there's some policy, some way of selecting actions in which you take your belief and you map your action. And this is beautiful theoretically. There's only, the solution is a policy, that is, it's a total function that maps any possible belief into some action. This is just like super cool, except there's only one little problem, or maybe it's a big problem. So even in the discrete case, this stuff is enormously complex. This is the size of the action, the state space, the action space, and this is the observation space. And then this is the horizon, the length of that you need to look ahead. So it's truly hopeless to do. And in the continuous case, it's even undecidable. So we're not going to do that this way. That is, we're not going to try to find a policy that we can solve for offline and somehow solve the problem. That is not going to work for us in the types of problems that we're interested in. So what are we going to do? So we're going to take some set of steps that ultimately are going to terminate in the only thing we know how to do, which is heuristic search. And in order for that to work, we need to have a small branching factor. We need to have effectively a short horizon. We need to be able to generate successors efficiently. And we need to be able to have a good heuristic. If we can do these things, then we can solve the problem. But it's not immediately obvious, I think, how you take the kinds of problems that we want to solve into something that looks like this. So what I'll try to do is give you some idea of what the steps are. So the first thing is taking inspiration from the AI planning literature. We're going to use symbolic rules to describe the dynamics of the domain. Okay. So basically, we're going to have a set of fluents that describe the state of the world, and we'll talk about what that really means later when we have belief space. But just think about, there's a set of statements. These statements are not going to be purely symbolic. They're going to have numbers in them eventually. But let's just say that there's a set of statements that that together we can use to describe the state of the world. And we're going to have rules that have preconditions, a set of statements that describe what must be true in the world. In some sense, these describe the subsets of the world under which this action would achieve the desired effect. For example, placing an object in some region, the precondition is to hold the object, and that there's a place where in the region that's reachable where I can put the object. Okay, so that's the idea. Now, will enable us to structure the search, and in particular, it will enable some powerful heuristics that we can derive from this representation. But there's a crucial difference between this and classic AI planning. So notice this condition here, which if you're going to operate in the real world, then clearly reachability, for example, is a big thing. You need to be able to reach things. However, we cannot in a simple way write down what the effects on reachability are of an action. We cannot assert reachability. So for example, here's this object A, and I move it. Okay, which reachability assumptions changed? Infinitely many, right? There are infinitely many spots. Many of them are now reachable that weren't before. Some are not reachable that were before. And so we cannot just say, I'm going to write a rule, and at some symbolic level, I'm going to assert what's reachable and what's not. We can't. So we're going to have some of the predicates, some of the fluents that we use to describe the world are not going to be in the effects of the action. They're going to be implicit. We're going to be able to test whether they're true, but we can't add them as effects of the action. So that substantially changes the nature of the enterprise. The classic AI stuff is an inspiration, but you can't just kind of drop it in. Is that clear? Okay. The other big issue has to do with actions. So if you take the actions that we care about, so for example, something like a pick operation. So a pick might involve arguments, which is which object you're going to pick, the pose that the object currently have, a grasp, and a robot configuration. The problem is that these are all continuous variables over very high dimensions. The robot configurations, our robot is a PR2. It has, I don't know, 17 degrees of freedom that matter for this. And that's that. The grasp has, I don't know, 6 degrees of freedom. The object pose has 6 degrees of freedom. And there are many objects, so they're both discrete parameters and continuous parameters. So this is a ridiculously large set of actions, right? And yet we have to find actions that matter. This is probably the hardest and possibly the weakest point in our approach. And we have some ideas on how to address this. But at the moment, what we do is we say, okay, part of what you need in order to represent this domain is you need to have a set of generators, a set of basically functions that, given one of these set of conditions, can generate values, can sample values that can potentially satisfy those conditions. Okay. So, for example, I have to be able to generate configurations of the robot that will grasp an object, or generate a pose that's in a region. So part of what we need is the ability to generate samples that are relevant to solving the problem. In general, be able to generate a sequence of finite concrete actions that we can at least plan with. I can talk more about that later if you're interested, but that's basically a key component of the approach, is to be able to sample the space of actions. And random sampling just will not do. In this kind of space, randomly sampling actions just doesn't make sense. In, you know, if you think about standard motion planning on RRT, it implicitly samples the actions by sampling points in the space, right? You sample a point in the space, and then you connect it to another point. That's an action, okay? But sampling these spaces and then trying to hope that it's going to make dinner for you, I guess, you know, we can, you know, we can write a paper that shows that it's probabilistically complete. But we wouldn't get dinner. Okay, so the other, what I've told you so far is to say, okay, I'm going to, how am I going to represent the space? I'm going to represent it using a set of these kind of hybrid assertions, the fluents. And that we're going to have a way of generating candidate actions that satisfy the conditions in the that can make, you know, that can hook up the output of one condition, the output of one action to the preconditions of another action. So we have to be able to do that. The other thing that we need to do is to have a heuristic. Now, there are different ways of trying to get the heuristic, and you'll see later. This is one simple approach. Imagine that you say, the way I want to do this, I'm going to do the standard forward sampling method in which I have a state, I sample some set of actions, I simulate them into the future, and I proceed, right, until I hope to get to a goal, and I'm going to have a heuristic. I want a heuristic that guides me towards reaching the goal. So the work of Kaelin Garrett that I showed you earlier is based on the idea of using a heuristic. This is an idea that came out of the AI planning literature, is that a good way of building a heuristic is by solving a relaxed version of the problem. So the way that the AI planners work is, if you have actions that are characterized by preconditions and effects which can be positive and negative, you take away the negative actions, the negative effects. So that means that if you ever achieve an effect, it stays. So it's a simplified problem. You can solve in polynomial time using that problem, and then you can use the plan that you constructed that way as a heuristic value, basically. That's a beautiful idea. So Kaelin generalized that to this kind of motion planning domain by basically saying, once I touch an object, it blows up. Okay, so as I touch more objects, I have fewer objects to deal with. It's the same kind of, you get the same kind of simplification, and you can get some effective guidance by basically building these plans using the simplified model. So that's one approach if you believe that you're going to do this forward chaining. And Kaelin's approach involves forward chaining. However, that would be too simple for us. Leslie and I like things more complicated. So we want to add another complication. Actually, it's not that we like it more complicated. It's just that it sort of feels like it's still not going to make us dinner. If we have to sit there and figure out actions, you know, and how to link them up from the beginning to the end, that's just too much to ask. Okay, it's still too long. So what we want to do instead is to use hierarchy. So what we'd like to do is break up the problem into pieces. None of the pieces is very long, so that we can get the short horizon. We get the long horizon solution by piecing together a bunch of short horizon plans. So that's the idea. And what we have is a remarkably greedy approach, which we called, the system that is called HPN for hierarchical planning in the now. And because this is incredibly greedy, you construct a plan at one level of the they're rare, and you know, you will see such things. But you know, Earl Sacerdoti had this idea for constructing hierarchies, in which the basic idea is to drop preconditions. So if you have, say, two operators here, there's pick, which achieves holding, and place requires holding, and that the robot is in the room to achieve that the O is in R. So what we do, I mean, that's basically, if you think about mapping one state to a set of possible output states, and then this requires a subset of these because it's a joint of those two conditions. So we can't necessarily put them together. We'd have to do more work. But what we're going to do is we're going to simply drop one of the preconditions, making this have a bigger set of input conditions that work. You can connect them at that level. And then you have a subproblem here, which you can then try to solve so you create a natural hierarchy that's not fixed. It actually depends on, you know, the plan that you're building. It gives you a way of constructing the hierarchy dynamically as you go. So that's the approach that we use in order to build the hierarchies. No, yeah.
So this is a hierarchy at the symbolic level of the planning. Is there something that you might have at the geometric reasoning level?
There could be. We have tried. So that's more standard. There's a kind of state abstractions, and this is a temporal abstraction. The thing that we're more concerned about is the long horizon. So this is the temporal abstraction. You can break up the world into pieces. Oh, I've got rooms, and I've got a building, and therefore to do planning. And we have tried that at different times. It's not a problem to add that in. We think the more challenging issue really is the temporal effect. We could be wrong, but that's where we put our emphasis. Now, the trouble is that now once you have these abstraction, these hierarchies, we don't know how to do the forward chaining anymore. Because the abstract operator, I can't simulate because it's not fully specified. I mean, the whole point of forward search in AI is you take a fully specified action, a fully specified state, and you get a fully specified result. Now we have these partially specified actions in which we haven't satisfied all the preconditions, and we can't simulate them forward. So, in fact, we don't actually do forward planning. We actually do backward planning, which is confusingly called regression. In the literature, or goal regression. This has been independently discovered by many people. I co-wrote a paper many years ago in which it was called pre-image backchaining, which is so much cooler a name than goal regression. But, you know, it just never caught on as much. So what can I say? And I'm still waiting for the Lozano-Perez theorem, and it's just never going to happen. I developed this algorithm in my thesis, which a lot of people have used, and they call it the star algorithm. And I'm going, what? Anyway, so the idea is that we're going to use goal regression. That is, we're going to start with a goal, and we're going to work backwards, right? So we're going to consider possible actions for achieving a goal, see what their preconditions are, and then backchain on that. And the termination condition is when the set of conditions that you have here, are satisfied by the current state. Okay, so that's the kind of standard backchaining. It has a number of advantages. One is that our description of the current state is immensely complicated. It's got, you know, all the geometry of the world and the robot and all this other stuff. So pushing all that detail forward is actually quite bad. Whereas going backwards, goals, which is what you're pushing backwards, are compact, right? So you would never, you know, that kitchen that we had at the beginning with all the other, you would never have that as a goal, right? Get my kitchen to look like this. That's just inconceivable, right? On the other hand, you know, make dinner is a compact goal, and as you go backwards, you tend to have relatively compact specifications. So the back chaining, which is at the level of goals, of subgoals to be achieved, actually is more manageable. And then all you need to be able to do is you need to be able to test whether the current state satisfies those conditions. And we keep our current state description in terms of a few basic primitive things like the poses of objects and the configuration of the robot. And anything else like relationships between objects, we just simply test to see whether they're true rather than try to assert them and back them out and so on. Okay, so that's the idea. Now, yeah.
Any issues that can come up if the goal isn't like also fully specified, like find me the book in my office and then pick it up?
Oh, no, there's no assumption that the goals are fully specified. You have to describe them at some levels. That is, there involves, in our case, a conjunction of fluents. But these are not fully specified. You can simply say, my goal is to have this object on that table, and I don't have to say anything else about the world, right? It's not at all full specified. Yeah. Yes?
For an example, for the video that you showed of moving the chairs out of the way, can you talk about what were these individual things that were specified and then how you searched over them?
The basic description of the environment. Okay, I haven't gotten. Can I wait?
Sure. Yeah.
Because the thing about that one is it was in belief space, and I haven't gotten to belief space yet. But the rough idea is there is a set of descriptions that are primitive, like the poses of objects and the configuration of the robot. And then there's, in addition to that, a set of relationships which are goals, like something being someplace. In particular, in the robot, the goal was simply have the robot out of the room. That was it.
So did it, like, how did it figure out that I can grab a chair over here?
We have a set of operators, which are pick, place, move, look. These are the basic operations. They're very, you know, there are many, many versions of that.
Those are specified beforehand, designed by human.
The basic operations are specified ahead of time and designed by a human, yes. Right. Now, you could imagine learning them or whatever, but what we're trying to do is we're trying to break up the overall problem of achieving a goal, like making dinner, into a finite set of these individual operators, which we've characterized in terms of their dynamics of what are the preconditions, what are their effects, and so on. Other questions? It's good to get them before I confuse you more. We're not done yet. Okay? I was telling some of the students earlier that the definition of a professor is someone who talks in someone else's sleep. I'm quite familiar with that that idea. So, but you know, I'd like to make it not true all the time. You know, it gets boring. I have to do that during the week at MIT. So, okay. So, once we're doing regression planning, oh, this is on video, isn't it? I've got tenure, doesn't matter. So we have regression planning. We're going backwards. So now our heuristic, our so-cool heuristic, doesn't work anymore. So we have to come up with a different heuristic. And in particular, the one that we, meaning Leslie, came up with was if you have a conjunction of goals to achieve, you look at the actions that could achieve it, and you look at their preconditions. And basically, instead of trying to consider achieving them all simultaneously, you try to achieve them only independently, which is a simpler problem which you can use as a heuristic. And you don't charge for achieving the same thing more than once if it appears at different points in the tree. So this is another instance of a simplified problem that you can solve in order to get an estimate of how far you need to go. So that works. Okay, so we've been talking about so far about trying to do actions that involve long horizon. We're going to break them up in, you know, hierarchically. We have a set of operators that model the you know, preconditions and effects. But we still haven't gotten to uncertainty. So let's talk about uncertainty now. So there are two kinds of uncertainty that matter. One is outcome uncertainty. So I do an action, and I don't know what happens. I might have some probability distribution over the outcomes. If you're used to the idea of an MDP has uncertain actions, uncertain outcomes, but you know the state. Okay, so let's just think about what happens. How do we do uncertain actions? And once you start getting to a situation like this, if you want to be optimal, what you need to find is a policy. Right? It's a recipe for what to do in every state. We're not going to do that. It is completely hopeless to think about what to do in every state in making dinner. But you forget it, right? So we're going to do online planning. We're going to find a plan We're going to get, you know, here's our environment. We have some state. We're going to get a planner. We're going to get the plan, and we're going to do the first step. We're going to do the action, and we're going to repeat. Of course, we're not actually going to do that, but this is the way to think about it, okay? We're actually going to be a little more clever, but we might do the first step and the second step before we need to replan, but that's okay. In principle, the idea is we're going to do online and then see what happens and then replan, okay? So the way we actually do this is we're going to do graph search, okay? And there's going to be probabilities on the different outcomes. And what you can think of there being is I have some state, and there's going to be, I do some action, there's some outcome, and I'm going to be in this state, and that has some weight, some probability, or, you know, which is that this is the cost, or which we're going to use the negative log probability. And then we're going to, this is the same action, the different outcome that tells you, gives you a different state. The same, the different action, different outcome takes you to that state. So you can set up basically a graph search in this kind of problem. And if you do a star on this kind of problem, the shortest path is the one which is the most likely. That is, it's the open loop plan with the highest probability. It's just a little trick, but it's basically just trying to do the, you know, to find a plan which has some probability of working, and then you're going to do it and then replan. Okay, now the other kind of uncertainty, which is current state uncertainty. So now we go into from the MDP to the POMDP. We don't know exactly which state we're in. Instead, we're going to operate on the probability distributions over the states. But we're going to take the same approach. We're going to have a state estimator, which is going to build a belief. So it's going to take our actions and our observations and build a probability distribution over the states of the world. We're going to take our planner, which is now going to have operations that describe the dynamics of the belief state. Okay, so this is problematic for a couple of reasons we'll talk about in a second. And then we're going to do the first step, and we're going to replan. So same idea that we did before. Now, the way, you know, one way of looking at this is that this is a planner that works in belief space, right? So there's a belief state here, and there's a plan, and you can think of this as the rest of the world. And in some sense, what the planner is trying to do is trying to convince the state estimator to generate a belief state that satisfies the goal. Okay, so that's one way of thinking about it. Now, the state estimator needs to be, honest and actually, actually represent the dynamics of the world. Otherwise, you know, it's like drug taking, right? I'm on the beach, yeah. It has to preserve the real world. Okay, so there's a couple of issues here. One is that we need to do belief update. So we need to represent the probability distribution over the states. This is not trivial. In fact, it's still quite hard to do in the general case. What we tend to do in our environment is fairly simple. We tend to have probability distributions over poses of objects. That's one of the things that we use to represent. In addition, we have free space. These two things are kind of complementary. You don't, even if you use the same data, the one is kind of object-oriented and tells you something about where the objects are, even though you didn't see all of it. And the other one tells you about where things are not, which you don't represent with just having a set of distributions over the objects. So it's very important, for example, if I want to move from one location to another, if I haven't seen what's in the way, I need to look there. Okay, so we need to update our belief over the states of the world using these two types of information. That's not something that's, as I said, trivial. We have a student, Lawson Wong, who finished a thesis recently trying to look at this problem. And I won't go into more details, but in practice, I mean, the state estimation is an area that is still problematic. When you think about real world and trying to build probability distributions about the real world, there, I mean, you know, Kalman filters, particle filters, not enough. There's still lots of work to be done there. I'm not going to dwell on it, but we're going to just take, we're going to do something reasonably simple. We have basically something that estimates the state the poses of the objects, basically a UKF, and we do an occupancy grid for the free space, and we basically we maintain them independently, and then when we have a query, we fuse them momentarily, give an answer, and then throw it away. That is, we don't. It is not a we don't try to approximate the posterior that captures the constraints between these two types of representations, because it's really, really tough. Okay, so, and ultimately what we end up with is a mixture of Gaussians and a uniform to represent the poses of objects. So I don't want to say too much more. Okay, so the basic query that we're going to be using in planning is we're going to ask about the mean pose of an object. So when we're doing our planning, we want to know where the mean is. And we're also going to want to know what the variance between the relationships between two objects. So I would like to know, you know, between this bottle and that, roughly what the variance of in the distribution between those two objects is. So that's the kind of queries that we do to our belief state. And then what we're going to be doing is we're going to want to do motion planning in that state, right? Remember, we're trying to plan the motions of a robot. So we're going to have to do motion planning involving the geometry, but the geometry is uncertain. So what we're doing is we're basically constructing shadows. Think of them as envelopes of the, you know, 90% probability or something. And we're going to construct shadows that capture our uncertainty. So the mean is going to be at the center of the shadow, and there's going to be some area around it representing areas where the object may be. And then, given the geometry of an object and its uncertainty, we're going to construct a shadow by taking each of the pieces and kind of roughly taking the sigma points of a UKF and wrapping a convex hull around it to get a shadow. So if you look at our at some of our pictures, you'll see things like this. We have gone back and forth on different representations as to whether the representation is done relative to the object or not. In some of the pictures I'll be showing you, the robot looks fuzzy, not because we're bad at graphics, which we are, although I used to teach it many years ago. But anyway, it's the, you know, you don't have to be good at it in order to teach it. Everybody knows that. I'm sorry, I'm running down professors, aren't I? That's because I'm just trying to jolly up the students. Anyway, so the so we have the, you know, the robot is uncertain here, and in this case the objects are not. So what we're going to do is we're going to use these shadows to do our motion planning. Okay, and the important thing is that we can use that to inform the regression. So for example, imagine that I'm considering a motion that goes from here to here. And I've got some uncertainty as to where that is. If I avoid the shadow completely, I don't even need to know anything about that object. Okay? I don't need to look at it. And, you know, according to what everything I know, it's going to be safe to make this motion. However, consider this motion, which I'm considering here. Now the shadow, I'm going to collide with the shadow, and that's going to tell me that I better look. Okay, that's as part of the regression. So in my plan, I need to include a look before I do the move. And then if I do a motion that wants to go here, I better plan to move this object out of the way if it is in fact movable. So we can use the geometric interactions between the robot and the shadows in order to inform the class of actions that we're going to need to do. And for example, it's very valuable in order to get a kind of cheap heuristic about what you will need to do in there.
Quickly.
Yeah.
And are the shadows defined in the global reference frame or also relative to other objects?
We've done a variety of them. So there's one version in which you define everything relative to the robot. Then when the robot moves, you have to update the shadows. There's another way in which you place them in a reference frame, and then as the object moves, it acquires uncertainty relative to the objects. So let's see, when these slides, many of these slides were made, we were using one representation. Our current code uses a different one. I'm not sure that there's a knockdown argument as to which is the best one. What is essential is that you need to represent relative uncertainty. So, for example, our current implementation in the UKF, we keep it's relatively few objects. We keep a full covariance estimate because what you don't want to forget is that if I've seen this object on the table and that object on the table, when I move over here, now they have become uncertain relative to each other. They become more uncertain relative to me, but not relative to each other. So we do keep information about covariance. That's essential in doing this. We talked about logical representations, and I used examples such as in and pose and so on. But in fact, is that in the presence of state uncertainty, I can no longer say this is in the region or make any assertions. I have to talk about the probability distributions. So the basic underlying belief state is the one that the UKF is maintaining. It says what the probability distributions over the states are. What we're doing is we're having an abstract representation that's easier to reason with and to project into the future. And that's the thing that the symbolic representations are representing. And what they are is basically there are two types of statements that we make for the discrete case. So something that's either true or false, for example, like whether A is on the table, you say that you believe this fluent has this value with some probability. And that's a statement that characterizes part of your belief state. And then for continuous distributions, in particular multidimensional distributions such as the pose of an object or the configuration of a robot, then in these cases you say something a little more complicated, basically saying something about the concentration of your belief over some part of the belief space. So you make these statements together, a set of these statements are a characterization of your belief state. It's the underlying belief state is that covariance matrix that the UKF is estimating. But then I have a set of symbolic representations. But symbolic doesn't mean devoid of numbers. In fact, they're full of numbers. But a representation which, for example, connects up with the preconditions of our actions. The preconditions of our actions are tests involving these symbolic representations. Does that make sense? I know it's 45 minutes into it and so on. Yeah. Okay. So the belief state that we use in our planner is a conjunction of these types of statements. Okay. So how does that work out in a simple problem? I'm just going to kind of quickly step through an example so you can see what we're talking about. So the problem here is we've asked the robot to take the blue box and put it on the side of the table. It starts out not knowing where the objects are, and then it's going to go and try to do it. So for example, it doesn't start out knowing that the red can. By the way, we will call that a soda box because inside the blue tape is a baking soda box, which, you see, those of you who believe that sensing will do away with all uncertainty, you didn't know that, right? And you're even though with all your good sensing. So there. Anyway, so the so we've asked to put the soda box on the side of the table, and it, you know, it's how do we plan that? So what we're going to do is, you know, we have our initial goal, be in. This is basically shorthand for the belief of in. And that the soda is on some target location. And it constructs a simple plan which says, place the soda and look at the soda. And the reason why that look is there is really to verify, because the conditions on our goal specify a certain variance, and the only way that you can achieve that is by looking. So the plan is, well, I'm going to look and I'm going to place. And you know, at this point, we've ignored preconditions like it's in the hand and all this other stuff, but we constructed a very simple plan. Then we go off and say, okay, place, let's try to do that. Well, that requires that the pose be at a particular location. What happened? Okay, here we go. So the location where we're going to place the soda is chosen on the basis of where we know the region and the clearance that we need in order to achieve with high probability that that the object is in there. In order to do that, before we can construct a plan to do that, we have a requirement that we know where the objects are well enough to construct a plan. That's a precondition to the operation. So it's going to look at the soda. There's a precondition that I know that we know where the soda is well enough, and we have to be able to see that where the soda is. So it does. That's loose conditions of the knowledge. But here, in order to make sure that we can actually see the soda box, it actually thinks about where can the robot stand so it can see it. Okay, so it has to pick configurations of the robot, and it models, you know, a little view cone and stuff like that to figure out whether where is there a place that I can see it. So it's going to remember that we're operating with a model here yet in which we don't know that where the location of the soup can is completely. So the way, you know, it starts out, this is the initial belief space. There's uncertainty. The red uncertainty represents uncertainty about the location of the can, and the blue represents uncertainty about the location of the object, of the soda box, and then this is the uncertainty of the table. And in this one, there's some uncertainty in the robot location.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
Does it need to know that there's a box and have like a reasonable initial covariance and mean? Or can you also handle if it has neither?
There have been versions of our code that can do either one. So there is a version of our code that started out with a set of objects that it knows about and an empty room. That empty room is covered in fog because it's never been there. And it says, I might know where the table is, but I don't know what's on the table. So it looks over there, and then new discoveries happen, and then the belief space is updated and so on. So you can do it either way. I think the current most recent GitHub release of the code assumes that all the objects have an initial covariance, but that's not, I mean, that's...
You can do this other procedure to initialize.
We have to get there. It's not just adding a little procedure in front, because you have to reason about moving to acquire the information and stuff, but it's something that we've done before and expect to do again. Good question, though. So you start out with this location. You move to the possible location to take a look. So it's using the nominal location, the mean locations of the objects, in order to do this plan. So it thinks that from that location, it should be able to look and see the soda there. So it moved a little bit off to the, that's why it chose to move over to the side, so it could look around the potential occlusion of the can. Then it looks, now it's a whole new ballgame, right? We have a whole new belief state. None of the plans we made are likely to survive, so we're going to replan, okay? So now we proceed on with this process and replan. We have to think about actually reaching the soda. Now, when you actually construct a plan to reach the soda, you notice that you collide with the can. right? So that was one of the things, you know, so the basic operation here is not finding a collision-free path. It's finding a path with few collisions. That's not the same thing. That is, a collision-free path has few collisions, but not all paths that we're interested in have no collisions. So this, some people, like Chris Hauser, call the minimum constraint removal problem. We don't really need it to be minimum, but it shouldn't be stupid. So that you can, you know, select an action, and then you examine it to try to do you know, you look at it and say, okay, well, I'll have to move that, and that's what leads to constructing this plan as you try to correct the issues that you find. I'm running out of time, so you can see that it's going to go over there to try to move the soda out, the can out of the way. One of the things that happens now, because of the hierarchy, it's not so smart. So it's going to go over there. It's going to go, okay, at this level of the hierarchy. Then it's going to say, no, I just picked up a lot of uncertainty moving here. This isn't going to work. Okay? And so what it's going to do is it's actually going to try to look, but it's going to find that the hand is in the way. And it has to move the hand out of the way because, you know, I've got this uncertain thing. It's going to go, oh, no, it's not going to work. So I go, whoop, okay, I have to move the hand so that it's not in the way. Then we're going to be able to look. Okay, and the process goes on and on and on and on, and we're going to go and move finally move the object out of the way, and then we're going to go back and move the thing. Okay, and just so that you know that it's not fake, you can see, have the real robot doing exactly what we talked about. And the, one of the things that's interesting is to, you know, to look at the head because it's deciding where to look, right? The plan consists of look actions, move actions, pick actions, and place actions. So it's deciding at every point in time where to look in order to do to get the observation that's relevant to achieving the goal in the belief space that it wanted. And let's see. Lately, we saw that we've been trying to work on how to incorporate learning into the system, not to replace the planning, but to enhance it. I don't have time to talk to you about that, so I think I will stop and thank you for your attention.
Some quick questions.
See, this is the sleep, where the sleep part comes in.
Maybe one question with, you chose a certain way to discretize, let's say, the action space, right? Where you say you have pickup, you have look, and things like that. And
you mean to break it up into that set of class of actions?
Yes, the planning then. Yeah. Could you imagine, and that's maybe because of that, you're getting these artifacts where you say it first goes there, and then it kind of has to move the hand away.
Actually, that's a hierarchy artifact.
Okay.
If you do it flat, it wouldn't do that.
Okay, but could you imagine that at some point your planning can be at a much higher level because maybe these low-level behaviors are just so robust that you just say, okay, go there and pick it up, where you don't even have to plan or reason about that it has to look, because the looking is part of that action already, of that behavior, so that you get really kind of very robust low-level kind of controllers.
One thing that didn't highlight very much, but for example, the controller for picking up is a policy. It goes, closes the fingers, touches the object, executes a little policy for centering the object, and so on. And all we need to do is characterize the preconditions under which we expect that action to succeed, and then we do it. So there's no problem with what you say, except for the characterizing the preconditions part. Okay, so just having a policy that to plug in there, sure, but if I don't know when it works, under what conditions it works, it's of no use to us, mm-hmm. Right? So if you can learn the policy and characterize its preconditions and effects, super. That's model learning, and we're all for that. Just having a policy that sometimes works?
No
good. Even if sometimes it's 75% of the time or whatever you like, it's not enough. because we have to do something. We usually have to do something. For example, if I don't have to look, but there's there's something in the way, right? I have to plan to make it so that in fact my little policy can succeed. So changing the level of the actions or changing what the actions are, perfectly fine, but you can't do away without the characterization of the preconditions. Anything else? Blake?
This is pretty far from what I work on or think about a lot, but can you kind of crystallize for me, like, what you motivated it with this very challenging, messy kitchen. So what parts of this, you know, are encouraging you that it will scale to the very messy kitchen and making dinner beyond the, you know, two objects on a table?
We've done more than two objects, but it's a good question. So the key thing is that you can deal with the actual uncertainty in the world in a tractable way, that in a way that doesn't depend on everything at once. So if you think about a state space for this problem. So it's the configuration space of the robot, the configuration space of every object in the world, and so on. So the key thing here is the fact that it's broken down so that I can most of the time think about only a couple of objects. And the fact that there's 20 other objects in the room doesn't affect anything I do, roughly.
Except that there, you know, those epsilon volumes will overlap for large numbers of objects on the clutter counter, right?
That's right. And so what that would tell you is I need to look. And by looking in a particular direction, you will then shrink the volumes.
Okay. So you sort of spend more time on sensing and reducing those and less time fumbling until you've got those things.
That's right. Yeah. So the what this provides is a way of guiding the sensing in connection with the task. So I don't have to come in and say, I need to know where every object is.
Yeah.
Step one. Step two, decide how to move them. That's not the what I need to do. So it's the coupling of the perception with the action because it's all part of the reasoning. So, I mean, we could do, we could do a demo in which we have a kitchen with 127 objects and then show you a messy kitchen but only focus on the same two objects. And now you would be impressed because, wow, they're doing a messy kitchen. But it wouldn't be any different, right? I mean, the whole point about this is that the rest of those objects, it's collision avoidance has always been a problem of mine. The rest of those objects are not going to come in to the problem in a very strong way. They come in a very weak way. So I think that's the key idea, that's why the symbolic representations and so on from AI are good, is because they enable abstractions in which you can deal with very complicated situations without having to think about everything at once. So that's my, yes?
So does that mean like in a situation, say it's not make dinner, but clean up this room, it won't get stuck in some sort of loop where it decides to pick up this object and put it away, and by the time it gets there, knows better state about some other object than tries to move over there, and you know, kind of gets stuck in some sort of.
No, that's an interesting question. There are ways of writing the hierarchy where you will fall into that loop if you're not careful. So there are issues that you will find other things. We've looked a little bit at this kind of problem. How to structure the hierarchy to get the right focus on the right problems and do things that way. But it's an interesting question. We've tried to write this in such a way that every action adds information, so there's always something changing. If you're ever in a situation where your belief state is not affected by some action, then you're in a loop. So you have to be careful. So let's see. If I gave the impression that all of the problems were solved, then that impression was false. I started off by saying I think the important thing here is the interaction between the perception and the action, the level of representation that you need. If you look at, there are three planning communities in that are relevant to this work. There's the AI planning community, and they have focused on these very clever ways of finding long-range plans, but not connected to the real world, to geometry in particular, and that changes the game. That's what I tried to show with that reachable thing. In motion planning, you can do geometry and you can do short-range plans, but because it's not factored, you're stuck in the state space. And when your state space, people say, motion planning, cool, we can do 20 degrees of freedom. No, it's 20 million is what we're worried about, okay? So we have to have some way of breaking the problem up into pieces, right? And that's what we can learn from the kind of AI planning representation. And then there's the uncertain planning, which are some beautiful mathematical algorithms, and half of the community shows that how intractable they are, and the other half wants optimal policies for them. Those two points of view only intersect at doing tiny problems very well. What I'm trying to say is, if you look at a realistic problem that we would like to solve, the assumptions that we make in each of those communities kind of break down. So I think this is not the answer. It's really the question, is can we come up with ways of trying to solve these kinds of problems at the scale that we need to them to be solved. So that's the...
All right, I think people have to start leaving too. Thank you very much.